with the pleasure of introducing the next speaker, and yes, it's a tip. So Tom Scalea, who very, very well known in our department. Everybody knows about his history. Everybody knows, you know, who he is and what he is and the spectacular lecturer he is. But he really, we really appreciate you coming up here, Tom. You didn't have to bring the Pope, but it was nice to meet you. Without any further claim to glory, it's Tom Scalea.
Injury care and emergency medicine really jump starts this. Now, this is accidental death and disability, the neglected disease of the modern society, 1966 IOM report, 50 years ago. It hadn't changed. Inadequate NIH funding, ED overcrowding, identified as a problem in 1966. Pretty interesting. I just pulled this with my AAST address. And the solutions, I'm on the IOM committee now. We're having the same freaking discussions in 2015 that they had in 1966. And so either they had huge vision or we just didn't get anything done, but the issues are still very, very, very much the same. And if you go back to the 2003 IOM report about access to emergency care, it's the same set of issues. Now, there's a certain amount of legitimacy that comes to emergency medicine. By 1979, the American Board of Medical Specialties recognizes emergency medicine. It was 9 years after residency training actually started. They were training kids without any real accreditation. 68 ASEP gets created, and in 69 ASEP has its first meeting. It's $50 to attend. There's 14 faculty and 128 people in the room. So you go this year, it'll be a little bit bigger than 128 people and 14 faculty. And first residency was in Cincinnati. And then at MCP, and Dave, all the people that are creating these departments, of course, are not emergency physicians. Internist in Cincinnati, Dave Wagner, a pediatric surgeon at the Medical College of Pennsylvania. His name will come back here in a second. Gail Anderson's an obstetrician. He starts the first medical school department at USC, and then Peter Rosen, an internist, I think. Oh, surgery, excuse me, of course. In the University of Chicago. And in 76, APEM is formed, but it's sort of given a provisional status because rather than just having emergency physicians on the American Board of Emergency Medicine parent disciplines, medicine, surgery, family medicine, actually populate the first American Board of Emergency Medicine. And as Mike said, at that point, emergency medicine, there were no departments. There was one real department in the country of USC, 71. Now you can get fast forward to the 80s and 90s, and a few, precious few, departments of emergency medicine actually exist. The story in Brooklyn is punctuated by a number of people. Only a few people know who this is. This is one of my real heroes in the world. His name's Jerry Shafton. Jerry, this is him at the AAST meeting last year with his wife Bernice, started the first trauma service in the United States, 1957, across the street. And Jerry was an early champion of organizing emergency care. He, when I first got here, would correct me constantly, because I would say emergency room, and he would say, no, Thomas, not a room, it's an emergency department. 1984. The original, the first real trauma service, this is a circa in the early 70s, a very young Sal Scofani. As he came, and then Jerry and Joe McCauley and Swami and the burn guy, I'm blanking on his name. Who was still, Winston Mitchell, still here when I was here. And this is the trauma service in 1984. So the relationship between emergency care and injury care was very, very tight across the street. Now, at that point, emergency medicine, there was no face of emergency medicine in downstate. It was a service. It existed only at the county hospital. And there were a myriad of people that ran the emergency department. The ED really ran them, I think. One was a psychiatrist. That was always an interesting experience. And there were internists, but it was mostly a conglomeration of people who were unemployable elsewhere. And a bunch of people who were moonlighters. The patients were cared for by gender. There was a male room and a female room, because it would be unseemly to put a woman in the same geographic vicinity as a man. Can't make this up. And the offices are still in the same place, right? C1, where our offices, we built the first set of offices. You walked in, you went to the right, that was the medical side. You went to the left, that was the surgical side. And the surgical side was staffed by unsupervised PGY2s. Now at that point, there was a single residency in the borough. It was at Brooklyn Hospital. And it was run by a lady named Nina Mazur, God rest her soul. And the conversation about how this starts begins with me having a drink with Kaylee and Nina Mazur. We were on Montague Street. The place is now It Takes Two to Tango. It didn't used to be It Takes Two to Tango. It was a bar. And I meet them for a drink, and Nina desperately wants to engage me on the role of emergency physicians in emergency department or academy, which was a conversation that didn't go very far. And who cares? It's just a freaking procedure. How can I train my residents to do it? We can train anyone to do it. It's not who's got the knife in their hand. It's about the system. And Kay, who was really the education person for the Department of Surgery originally, also who sadly died very recently, she gets this idea. Ike Wiener is the dean. And so Kay won't let it go about creating emergency medicine. So Ike calls Dave Wagner, the pediatric surgeon, and says, I'd like you to do a consultation. David comes to Brooklyn, and he interviews people. And he comes to sit with me, and he says, I knew him, kind of from around the circles, and he says, what do you think? And I said, it's never going to happen. It's simply not going to happen here. The chair of surgery, the chair of medicine, aren't going to allow this to happen. And actually Lou Goldberg came to visit, and he ran into the chair of medicine, and he said, what are you doing here? And he said, well, I came over to talk. He said, there's never going to be an emergency medicine residency here. There's never going to be a department. It's over my dead body. Turned out to be kind of prophetic. Unbeknownst to me, he writes this consultation report, gives sense to the dean, and says, you should create a department of emergency medicine. You should make Tom Scalea chairman. He's the only person that will be able to drive this through. Who knew? Now, two things happened in 1991. This is Libby Zion. This drives all of the way things change. It happened in New York, as it often does, right? So most people know the story. She dies from whatever it is she had. Her dad, Sidney Zion, the investigative reporter from the New York Daily News, I think, blows this up in a four-part, scathing set of exposés that demonstrates she died never having been seen by an attending physician. Now, the resident, the medical resident who prescribed IM Demerol for her agitation over the telephone, never going to see her, When the lawsuit happens, reported on Court TV, first malpractice case ever on television, says that I was tired. He actually lived in the hospital about 17 hours at the time. He didn't even meet duty hour restrictions. That's Yanko Rosenbaum. Now, as Mike told you, the Grand Rebbe is driving down Eastern Avenue and knocks these two kids down. The rest of that story is the hot Hotzola ambulance arrives, takes the Grand Rebbe away, leaves the two kids on the street. Yanko Rosenbaum, a rabbinical scholar, is walking home from Temple and sustains about a dozen stab wounds to the thoracic abdomen, both sides, gets brought in, is cared for by an unsupervised PGY2. Now, the trauma attending is in the operating place. The burrow burns. You can see the flames from outside of the hospital. Trauma attending's in the operating room doing a total gastrectomy back when that, for stress gastritis, when that was a disease. The next kid comes in with a gunshot wound to the carotid. That kid goes upstairs. At some point, see, nobody actually, he never gets a chest x-ray because the mayor arrives. So the mayor has to talk to him. And when they get the chest x-ray, he's whited out his left chest. He had a right side of the chest, so he whites out his left chest. They put a tube in to take out about 2.5-3 liters of blood. They call the trauma attending who says, I can't do the third room. So the trauma attending, Sharon Henry, utters the words for which I've still not forgiven her, call Tom. My phone rings, he dies on the table. We never actually opened his chest. That creates another five-part expose, this time in Post. Chairman of Surgery falsifies the unsupervised PGY2 because she never took ATLS. She takes ATLS, he dates it from before. He loses his job. Chief of Medicine moves to Maryland. He's the guy that recruited me away to go to Fishhawk Trauma. Now, so it's now about the 27th, 1991 of August. And I'm walking across the street and the beeper goes off. And the principle is, if you've been in a place for 10 years and the beeper goes off and you don't recognize the number, it's a bad thing. So I call Office of the Dean. Oh, this is not good. Doctor, we don't like to see you, Dr. I said, I'll be happy to make an appointment. No, he'd like to walk over right now. So I walk in, most of you, none of you guys do it. Ike was great. You didn't. You didn't. So you walk into Ike. Ike's a chain smoker. The whole office is full of smoke. And his ashtray, which is full of butts, is one of the things that this huge medallion that says the Surgeon General has determined that cigarette smoking is bad for your health. And he said, I have been pretty unhappy, my chairman. I mean, he said, I hear you don't like your chairman. Yes, sir, that's true. He said, I hear you're looking for a job. Yes, sir, that's true. He said, you don't want to leave Brooklyn, though, do you? No, sir, I don't. He said, well, I've got the perfect opportunity for you. He said, I've just created the Department of Emergency Medicine, your chairman. And he said, oh, by the way, did you wear a suit? No, sir. He said, that's okay. I know exactly where you live. You have a press conference with the mayor in an hour. Please don't be late. And I sort of stood there and looked up. He said, if you keep standing there, you're going to be late. There's a car waiting for you outside. Please leave. I went home. I got, put my suit on. I walked onto the stage with the mayor, Dave Dinkins, Mr. Dinkins, and they were 200 or 300 press people. He says, you guys all know Tom Scalea. I was a relatively well-known guy. He said, he's now the chairman of the Department of Emergency Medicine. He'll be happy to take your questions, the mayor will also. We now have a department. I walked in, the guy that was running the ED, Ed Fishkin, was running out. Is he still running? He's over the window. He wasn't here anymore. So the first faculty meeting was really pretty easy. It was me and Shelley. We sat in the office. There wasn't an awful lot of space. And then the next day, Ray Austin, Luke Hull, and Rich Sinner walk in and say, well, I know that you're going to want to recruit your own welcome. I know you're going to want to recruit your own faculty. Here are letters of resignation so that you can we'll get out of your way. One day, I picked them up, I tore them up, I said, do you really think I'm that stupid? You're not going anywhere. I'm here, you're here. To say we were in over our head was an understatement. We just did, we were too stupid to know. Now, we pieced together a faculty with some people that were here. Doctors Shetty Hegde, Ziad Abulazi, and yes, Mad Dog Dennehy started to sculpt the halls yet again. And then we recruited, the American Board of Emergency Medicine was willing to let me support faculty to grandfather them for the boards. They just weren't willing to let me take the boards, which I thought was a curious thing. We recruited Bonnie, Ron Lowe, Stephen, Todd Hager, Jerry Kessler, Casey, Kelly Robinson, we're starting to get a faculty together. I remember interviewing Mike, because Mike was down in New Brunswick, we're up on my first floor office, and he said, yeah, I